God bless us and make an important part of our church. I hope you might be thinking about one of the ways you can bless the children in our church, or maybe consider serving in our children's ministry as we have opportunities to come up in the future. I want to invite you right now to open your bulletin. You'll see your sermon notes. We're beginning a four-week sermon series on the prophet Elijah. And Elijah, he's one of the greatest prophets, one of the greatest characters in the people of the Old Testament. We're going to be talking about it in 4 weeks. And so I want you to see your sermon notes. There's a place for you to write down anything you'd like to remember to take with you. There's also a few pictures and a little map that will help you to kind of think about our story today. And also there'll be some scriptures and some of our main points listed for you. So if you follow along with that, if you open that flap up, you'll also see our prayer and study guide, which has daily scripture readings. Hope you'll take this with you and spend even 5 minutes each day reading your Bible, reading these devotions, and talking and listening to God in prayer. That's one of the ways that we grow to know God and to hear God's voice in our lives. Well, we're going to be talking about the Elijah, okay? And I want to kind of set the context, the historical context of the time in which he ministered and lived. Up until the kind of the 200 years almost previous to Elijah, Israel had experienced a run of 19 consecutive evil kings. They weren't just ineffective, you know, just not very good at their jobs. They're leading the people astray, 19 in a row for about 200 years. And then we get to the king and queen that Elijah's going to be interacting with the most, King Ahab and Queen Jezebel. Put this little verse in your notes. This is, wouldn't you love this to be what it says about you? Hopefully not. 1 Kings 16:30 says, Ahab, son of Omri, did more evil in the eyes of the Lord than any of those before him. So, the Bible is saying he's the worst king of all, and he's married to evil queen Jezebel. Now, I'm going to make a confession to you today. When I was young, growing up, my brother and I used to watch Mid-South Wrestling, and Jim Ross would be on there, and he would refer to any evil or villain woman as, oh, she's such a Jezebel. And well, he was referring to this lady here, Queen Jezebel, maybe the most wicked woman who ever lived. So, here's what they did that was so bad. Ahab and Jezebel led the people astray. They led them from worshiping the one true God, the Lord, to worshiping the false gods of Baal and Asherah. Why was this so bad? Well, okay, it breaks one of the Ten Commandments, that you should love the Lord your God, you know, worship only Him. But also, the practices of following these false gods were also bad. Some people would sacrifice their children to these false gods. Some of them would go into the temple and have sex with prostitutes and call it worship. They do gross things. And this goes on and on. People have turned their backs on God. They've walked away and they're following these false gods. And finally God says, you know, enough is enough. And so what did God do? God send an army, raise up an army to go and defeat Ahab and Jezebel and put a new rule in place? Well, no. In our instance today, God does what God often does. God raises up one man, a prophet, to confront this evil king and queen. And I would argue today that God's still in this kind of work, and God may raise up one person to make a big difference from our church, or many people from our church, to raise up individuals to make a Christian difference here in this world. God may raise up a young business leader to take a stand for integrity, maybe in a business that lacks integrity. Or God may raise up one person to engage the political system, to make change in the criminal justice system. I was in the Kiva class last week, and Lou McGinnis was talking about